Okay, two exits, one fish. In this episode, we saw Leanne and Mike both tap out. They both made exits. How do you feel about seeing them both go?
It's always heartbreaking seeing people tap out, but I also find it really interesting to see the reasons that they do. With Mike, it was obviously a medical episode and, you know, we could really see his fear.
He was scared.
Yeah, poor love. And it's a long way. Like it's like out there in the dark alone with knowing that's a long time to get help. That's a scary thing when there's a medical episode. And then with Leanne, we've got the very obvious realization she has that family is her survival item. And like I really loved seeing how she listened to that internal authority and made the choice to go in her own rightness.
At least she's got bragging rights over Rob.
Forever and ever.
We saw some of the participants start foraging. Andreas went out, he turned his underpants into an actual nutsack. But he did bear some fruit, so to speak. He found miro berries and mamaku ferns. I mean, that's going to be pretty useful for him to know that that's nearby.
Yeah. And what we see is also something that I find to be quite true about bush food, which is it generally tastes like shit. You can go through all the huge emotional and mental lift of discovering there's food on the landscape and going, oh my God, this is fabulous. And then you got to make a fire and cook it up. And there's like,
what does it taste like? It just tastes like
dirt and sticks in general. Yeah. Or you might have a little fruit, and we're used to our giant strawberries and our huge watermelons and, you know, our fruit that you get from the supermarket. Whereas when it's bush food, it might be a berry the size of half your fingernail and most of its seed. And it's more of a homeopathic effect rather than a nutritional one. But it's got the antioxidants in it. But it is a huge psychological lift when you find food.
Mm-hmm. We saw Andreas and Chase actually go out hunting. No luck on the land. What's the benefit of going for a deer rather than going fishing, for example, or would you go the other way around?
My strategy would always be to go for whatever is going to be the easiest. Like for me, conservation of energy is the number one law of survival. Like you need to look at your calories in and your calories out. Simple maths. So splurging a whole bunch of energy tromping through the landscape, through landscape that's so thick you can't find your way through it, to possibly stagger upon a deer in your first 2 days when you haven't figured out where they all are yet. I mean, that's a lot. Whereas you got a lake that's right there and there's worms in the ground. And as we saw with Chase, you know, he had multiple lines out and all he had to do was sit and watch them.
Mm.
You got a bit bored, but, you know, it paid off. He ended up with a fish. And I've got to say, I'm like watching him catch that fish. It's like, that is four times the size.
Sitting next to you watching these episodes, I'm getting so much resentment from you. I don't blame you either.
No, every alone has its challenges, but seeing how much food is actually there, yeah. I'm definitely, you're getting the blue version. Like, you bastards, you got that giant fish. It's four times the size of anything that guy pulled out of the water.
Well, it's certainly a land of abundance, New Zealand, isn't it?
Looks like it, yeah. It looks like there's going to be game. I'm a bit excited to see who's going to pull in what. Yeah. And if we're getting a fish that size after only 5 days, I reckon there's a good chance that once people hook into the fishing, that will keep them sustained while they then crack into the hunting.
Oh, so you'd complement the fishing with the hunting?
Absolutely. Like really, you want to have as many strategies as you can out there, because the thing is that the fish, they change their bite depending on what the weather's doing, what the air pressure's doing, you know, what their breeding cycle's doing. Trout, when they're shagging, they're not eating. So if they're breeding, they go off the bite. And it's winter, so they're probably breeding.
Mm.
And having one avenue of food production is basically just to get yourself set up so that you can then use that as a base to move into big game and gathering.
Mm, let's talk a bit more about the land. When we saw Andreas and Chase go out hunting, it looks dense. That's like a calorie burner right there, right?
It is so brutal. There's so much about this landscape that reminds me of where I was in Lutruwita. It's different, but it's that the same level of density, the like wet, soggy, lots of moss, having to fight through bush that's so dense that every time, you wouldn't be seeing this, but every time you move through that kind of bush, the trees above dump all of their rain on you. So it's just this constant rainfall. Everything's wet.
Cold. 1 to 2 degrees.
1 to 2 degrees. So it's pretty bitter. It's pretty cold. And the other thing is that this sunshine is a real issue. Mm. So it said in this episode that they get, I think, 7 meters of rain.
7 meters in 200 days.
That's a lot of rain. Mm. That means there's a lot of cloud. That means there's not much sun.
How does that compare to Tassie?
So Tassie, we got 2.5 meters of rain a year, and that was, I reckon, it all happened in the time that I was out there. Yeah. I don't know how it's spread out for this lot, but because they've got these high mountains in Aotearoa, and they've got it's the New Zealand climate, so there's just so much more rain. Yeah, lack of sunshine. It's the kind of thing that actually makes people tap out, not having the sun.
Yeah, it seemed like a significant reason for Tamika to move camp when she was there. Was that shot of her on one bank in complete shade, looking across the water at the other in complete sunshine. How do you rate her move, and particularly at this point?
Yeah, that move is super smart. I think if she'd stayed there, she would have been buggered. Mm. But because she moved early, like, you only want to move while you're still sort of fat and full of calories, really. Mm-hmm. It's such a, in building a shelter is a huge calorie burn anyway, but moving 100 kilos of gear through that terrain, if she'd left it, it just probably would have been too much for her. But because she made the choice to do it early, it was a big call and a big choice, but it was a really, really smart move. And for her to now have sunshine, you could see how much drier her place is. I think she's really set herself up.